Not so long ago, superhero stories were a bit limp.
You prefer the old one, yeah. Hasn't got his cape either.
Actors were told doing a movie could end their careers, and once powerful comic book houses were running out of money. So one hired a small group of creators to try and turn things around. A decade later, and many of the most iconic superhero stories, you know, the ones that grossed billions of dollars, were turned into Hollywood movies and kickstarted a new fascination with superheroes, came from this man.
Well, it's funny, we think of comic book movies now as like they're indestructible, they've been around forever, but anybody who grew up through the 90s will know it was far from it. You know, there was all these terrible superhero movies getting made in the 90s, and it was even seen as risky to do a Batman movie back then. You know, they couldn't get Superman right. They were trying it over and over again. And Marvel itself was actually going into bankruptcy in 1999. They were filing for Chapter 11. So it was very famously in a bad spot, and they had to eventually rely on cheap labour like me.
Mark Millar had just turned 30 when he started working for Marvel. He'd grown up in a working class family just outside Glasgow, but had to drop out of university age 19 after the death of his parents. With very little money, Mark went to his local library every day and worked on submission scripts to try and make it as a comic book writer. And it paid off. Mark landed a gig writing for the British comic 2000 AD, and after years keeping his head just above water, eventually took over writing The Authority.
That changed my life. That book changed everything for me.
The Authority became so popular, it drew Marvel's gaze. Editor-in-chief Joe Quesada invited Mark to revamp their iconic core characters.
And I remember going in for my first meeting and asking if there was a coffee machine, and they said, we can't afford the coffee machine. And somebody told me that they'd actually sold the doors to their meeting room. They'd sold the doors on eBay and everything, you know. So, like, things were so bad.
But the thing with being at rock bottom is no one's particularly precious. Mark had the freedom to restart these 40-year-old franchises from scratch, throw out all their baggage, and do whatever he wanted.
And that was really exciting for me, actually. I just thought, this is a chance to be Stan Lee, to come in and just start it from issue one again.
While his colleague Brian Michael Bendis was given Spider-Man, Mark was given X-Men, and they both worked from one key idea. What if we
created the Marvel Universe as if it was happening right now instead of 1961?
This wasn't fantasy like Narnia or Middle-earth. These new stories would be set in modern-day America, the reader's America.
Because then it's going to seem amazing. If some guy swings by in a web past your house, it's pretty spectacular, you know? I think the very first one I did was X-Men, and it was quite easy for me to write from a newcomer point of view, because I was kind of a newcomer to that stuff. I hadn't read X-Men growing up, and I gave them all the wrong powers. I had Wolverine flying or something, all this kind of stuff. And it kept getting sent back to me, and they said, look, go and look this up online, you know?
Thankfully, once he'd done his research, Ultimate X-Men was a huge success.
And the way Marvel works, which I love, is if you have any kind of success there, they just say, what else do you want to do? So, like, I did X-Men, it came in as the number one book, and then they said anything else, and I was like, well, the Avengers would be cool, so I did that. And just then I did Wolverine, I did Spider-Man and so on, and everybody stayed out of my way. They just let me crack on and do what I wanted to do with the characters, and each one was kind of bigger than the last. So it was a lovely period, it was great.
War has started.
What no one realised at the time was that Mark was writing the blueprints for the Marvel Cinematic Universe. His series, The Ultimates, was the major inspiration behind 2012's The Avengers movie and was Time magazine's comic book of the decade. Mark went on to write Old Man Logan and the Captain America Civil War storyline, which became one of Marvel's biggest commercial successes. The creative freedom Mark had in that office with no doors or coffee machine had paid off. But a conversation with Stan Lee was about to change everything. In 2003, Mark was interviewing Stan Lee for a feature in SFX magazine.
And he said, yeah, but you should go and do your own stuff. And he'd read what I'd been doing. And he said to me, I feel you'd be really good at creating your own characters. And I'd never considered it until that point. I'd always just wanted to work in other people's characters. And I thought Stan would be impressed, but he couldn't care less. He was just like, trust me, go and create your own stuff. And the next day, you know, if Stan Lee tells you to do something, it's a bit like, you know, Moses, isn't it? You know, being told by the burning bush to go and do something, you know? So the next day I remember buying a pad, and I went on the train, and I sat with a pen and wrote out the idea for Wanted. And a few months later, I had a movie deal with Universal and everything. And I was like, this is really easy. You know, you just write it down and send it away, and they give you a movie. And Angelina Jolie's now going to be in that. It's brilliant. Stan was right.
And how did the actual interview go?
The audio wasn't working. I was recording it, and I interviewed him for 2 hours, and halfway through it, I noticed that it wasn't taping. And I was like, oh my God, right? And because he was Stan Lee, I was too embarrassed to say, this isn't working, can we do all this again, you know? So what I did, and I've never told anyone this before actually, what I did was I faked it. I roughly remembered what Stan was saying and I just typed it up. But Stan Lee sounds so much like Stan Lee that it's quite easy to kind of fake it. So it was a Q&A text interview for a magazine I was interviewing him for. And Stan didn't even notice. I sent it to him for approval and Stan was like, yep, looks great, you know, and as it was fine, it was okay.
So in 2004, Mark started his own company, Millarworld. Over the coming years, he wrote Kick-Ass, Kingsman, and Jupiter's Legacy. He'd helped transform comic books from niche to mainstream and turn them into staple modern storytelling genres. Under his direction, superhero stories no longer need to be about guy gets powers, guy makes a costume, guy fights a supervillain. Miller's stories go deeper, with characters that are just as human as they are super, living in the world we're in right now.
My thing I'd say to everybody is just think, what will Marvel and DC never dare do? You know, start where they draw the line. That's really interesting. And that's what I've done with Jupiter's Legacy. I was reading a lot a few years back about 1929 and the Wall Street crash. And I was like, this all looks a bit familiar. And then weirdly now, the other cycle of history that's been repeated is coming out of a massive global pandemic as well. You know, so it is really odd. Like, these things do tend to move in these cycles. And I wanted to do a story about that. Like, the rise of nationalism is another thing. You know, like after the financial crash in 29, for the next decade, you had people turning to extreme, radical, generally right-wing solutions. And we're seeing that again now. And Jupiter's Legacy, if it's about anything, is about breaking the cycles of history.
Do better next time.
You know, so the idea is that it's kind of boomers versus millennials, really. You know, it's like the kids looking at what the parents have done with their lives and thinking, you guys could be doing so much more, you know. Instead of catching bank robbers and all the stuff Marvel and DC movie characters have been doing, you know, fighting supervillains for 90 years, we could actually be stopping starving in Africa. We could be stopping human rights abuses in other parts of the world and everything, you know, and actually turn the place into a utopia.
Petra, I know you don't...
I'm not you. I can't keep taking hits and just get back up. I can't watch my friends die because some asshole.
But the story's all about people thinking that extreme solutions are the best solutions and it going horribly wrong, you know, and using history as a guide for it. So I'm making it sound quite intelligent, actually. I'm quite looking forward to watching this myself. It sounds pretty good.
For more deep dives into your favourite Netflix shows, stick around on this Netflix channel.